فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
And number five, الطيب, perfume. Number five is الطيب, perfume. Number six, it is not allowed for a person قتل الصيد البري, to hunt wild animals. To hunt wild animals. And in this point, we mentioned that it is aslan, is not allowed for a person to hunt in Mecca, in the haram. Anyone, whether they're muhrim or non-muhrim. But the muhrim, the person who's in the state of ihram, is not allowed to hunt anywhere. Meaning, if I get into the state of ihram right now in London, I'm not allowed to go and start hunting. I'm not allowed to start hunting anywhere. The person who's muhrim is not allowed to hunt. Nor is he allowed to point and say, look, there's an animal there, go hunt it. He's not allowed to say that either. Nor is he allowed to help by get the weapon of the hunting, the gun or something like that, and give it to the person who wants to hunt. Those three things are not allowed. But is he allowed to eat from the thing that is hunted? We say that he is allowed if the thing is not hunted for him. That it is allowed if the thing is not hunted for him. This, when the companions, they hunted a wild al-himar al-wahshi, al-himar al-wahshi. And they say it might be a zebra. Al-himar al-wahshi is a wild donkey in the Arabic language, they say. Al-himar al-wahshi, a wild donkey. And they say it might be a zebra. When the companions, they hunted it, and one of them wasn't in the state of ihram, the rest were, and they didn't help him. They saw it. So they didn't even point to it, they just started looking at it. And the companion who was not in the state of ihram got on his horse and was about to go hunt it, but he forgot his weapon. So he asked him, give me my spear. So when they said no, they didn't do anything for him. So he got angry, he got up, he got down, he got his rumh, his spear, he got on his horse, he went and he captured hunted the animal. Then when he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in the state of ihram, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ate from it because he wasn't necessarily hunted for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that's why he ate it. So it's allowed to eat it if it's not hunted for you. Number seven, عقد النكاح, to get married. It's not allowed for the person who is in the state of ihram to get married. And any person who does get married in the state of ihram, then the nikah is fasid, is not correct. Meaning they have to do another nikah. The nikah is wrong. Number eight, al-jima' is have intercourse. It's not allowed. And if a person does do this, then he's done a sin. And he has to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he has to carry on doing his hajj, even though his hajj is now null and void. He has to carry on and finish his hajj, even though it's null and void. And he has to do hajj again in the next year. According to some ulama, and some say he just has to repay his hajj. But according to al-Nawawi, he says, عَلَى الْفَوْرِ, he has to do it next year, hajj again. That's why it's a big penalty. This is one of the worst things that you can do in the state of ihram, and to have intercourse, haram. And it's a major sin, they say. Number nine, al-mubashara bishahwa, to touch skin of your wife or something like that with shahwa, desires. That's not allowed. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ حَجَّ الْبَيْتَ فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِّ يعني قراءة فَلَا رَفَثُمْ وَلَا فُسُوقُمْ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِّ يعني I'll to do الرفث, which is الجماع ودواعي. It is to have intercourse and anything that leads to it. So touching it with desires is not allowed. So those are إجمالا, the summary of the things that are not allowed in the state of ihram. And the Shaykh رحمه الله تعالى says, ولا يجوز للمحرم بعد نية الإحرام سواء ذكرا أو أنثى أن يأخذ من شعره أو أظفاره أو يتطيب. He's not allowed to take his hair or his nails, or he's not allowed to put on perfume. ولا يجوز للذكر خاصة أن يلبس مخيطا. It's not allowed for a man to wear the clothes. يعني على هيئته التي. So I'm just going to go through it because we went through most of this, and I'll translate some of the points, the main points. يعني على هيئته التي فصل وخيط عليها كالقميص أو على بعضه كالفناء. كالفانلة والسراويل والخفين والجوربين إلا إذا لم يجد إزارا جاز له لبس السراويل وكذا من لم يجد نعلين جاز له لبس الخفين من غير قطع لحديث ابن عباس الثابت في الصحيحين أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من لم يجد نعلين فليلبس الخفين ومن لم يجد إزارا فليلبس السراويل. And they say that a person who is not able to find, he doesn't have sandals, then he's allowed to wear socks. Khuffain, leather socks basically, that goes above his ankle. And this is not allowed at all. Bil ijma', as Nawawi says, is not allowed for a person to wear al-khuffain except in this situation, which is if he doesn't find sandals which do not cover his ankles and his toes. But if he doesn't have any sandals which cover his toes and his ankle, then he's allowed to wear leather socks or shoes. Basically, he's allowed to wear those things. He's allowed if he is not able to find it. If he's able to have the sandals, then yarhamukallah. And if he's not able to find sandals, then he is allowed to wear it. And if he is able to find sandals, then he's not allowed to wear it. And if he does wear it, then he has to pay fidya. نعم. وأما ما ورد في حديث ابن عمر عن عمر بقطع الخفين إذا احتاج إلى لبسهما لفقد النعلين فهو منسوخ. We mentioned this yesterday that they say that one of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that if a person is not able to find sandals, then he wears socks and he cuts what is above the ankle. And we mentioned yesterday that this ruling is منسوخ, abrogated. This abrogated. And he mentioned this here, and you can go back to him. And he says, وَيَجُوزُ لِلْمُحْرِمِ لُبْسُ الْخِفَافِ الَّتِي سَاقَهَا دُونَ الْكَعْبَيْنِ لِكَوْنِهِمَا مِنْ جِنْسِ النَّعْلِينَ. And they say that he is allowed to wear socks that are below the ankles because they are considered to be from the sandals, basically. وَيَجُوزُ لَهُ عَقْدُ الْإِزَارِ وَرَبْطِهِ بِخَيْطٍ وَنَحْوِهِ لِيَعْدَمِ الدَّلِيلِ لِلْمُقْتَضَى لِلْمَنْعِ. And he's allowed to wear now, you know, the towel, the rida, the things that you wear underneath, the izar you wear below your lower body. They say that you're allowed to have it to be tied, and like this, you know, tied, like a ma'wis. They're allowed to wear it tied. You're allowed to wear that. They say that. Even though some ulama, the reason why I mention it is because some ulama say it's not allowed. But it was narrated by Ibn Umar that he would do that. So they said, the Sheikh al-Bazi says that it's allowed, rahimahullah ta'ala. وَيَجُوزُ لِلْمُحْرِمِ أَنْ يَغْتَسِلَ وَيَغْسِلْ رَأْسَهُ وَيَحْكِيهِ إِذَا احْتَاجَ إِلَى ذَلِكَ بِرِفْقٍ وَسُهُولَةٍ فَإِنْ سَقَطَ مِنْ رَأْسِهِ بِسَبَبِ ذَلِكَ فَلَا حَرَجَ عَلَيْهِ. He's allowed to scratch and he's allowed to have a shower. He's allowed to do that. But he's not allowed for a woman. وَيَحْرُمْ عَلَى الْمَرْأَةِ الْمُحْرِمَةِ أَنْ تَلْبِسَ مَخِيطًا لِوَجْهِهَا كَالْبُرْقَعِ وَالنِّقَابِ. We say that a woman is not allowed to wear al-burqa' or niqab or liyadeha, and she's not allowed to wear socks, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in hadith al-Bukhari, لا تنتقب المرأة ولا تلبس القفازين. The woman in the Sahih al-Bukhari says that they're not allowed to wear niqab, and the woman is not allowed to wear gloves as well. نعم. ويباح لها من المخيط ما سوى ذلك كالقميص. And she's allowed to wear anything else. وكذلك يباح لها سد الخمام. And it is allowed for her to cover her face. And this is based on the Sheikh Ibn Baz رحمه الله تعالى. He mentions that it is wajib for a woman to cover her face. And this is based on the opinion that the face is awra, according to Hanabila. And they say that the face is awra, therefore it is wajib upon a woman to cover their face. And that is the opinion of the Hanabila. And the other opinion is that the face is not awra, and the niqab is not wajib. كان ولذلك عائشة رضي الله عنها, when some men would come and she's in the state of ihram رضي الله عنها, men would be past, travelers, they would go past, she would cover her face when the men were coming past, because even though she was in the state of ihram, she would cover it with a cloth or al-khimar, her khimar. So she would take it and put it above. And so you find these days, if you go to Mecca, you'll see that the women, they have a cloth. They don't wear the niqab when they're in the state of ihram. They would take a cloth and they put it a semi see-through cloth, so she can see out, but you can't see in. So they wear that and just to cover their face, and it's allowed. And rather, according to opinion, it is wajib. It's obligatory according to the opinion of the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala. وأما ما اعتاده كثير من الناس من جعل العصابة تحت الخمار. Some women now you find that what they do is that they take their khimar, the cloth that they put above their face, but they wear like a hat. So they tie something on their forehead, and it has something like this, like a cap or something like that, just to make sure that the khimar does not touch their face, because they think that it's not allowed for the khimar to touch their face. And Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, فلا أصل له في الشرع فيما نعلم. He says, I don't know any reason for a person to do that. I mean, they don't have to do that. And you find people doing that today. But the Shaykh says that you don't have to do that. And if this was legislated, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would have told... Sorry about that. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would have told us to do that. So what some people do, they wear a cap and they put their khimar on top of that, so it doesn't touch. It's like this. You understand? And some of them, they wear it outside. They wear a cap outside like that. And the Shaykh said, and this is called al-isabah, ma yushaddu ala al-ras. The Shaykh says there's no reason for a person to do that. ويجوز للمحرم من الرجال والنساء غسل ثيابه التي and is allowed for a person to wash their clothes. Some people believe that they have to wear their ihram for the whole 5 days or 6 days and not wash their clothes. You're allowed to take your ihram, wear another one, and you're allowed to wash that one as long as you make sure that you don't put perfume on it. And if a person does put perfume on it intentionally, not forgetful, not out of forgetfulness or out of ignorance, then they have to pay a fidya. So it's not allowed. This is one of the mahdurat. They're not allowed to wear perfume. ولا يجوز له لبس شيء من الثياب مسه الزعفران والورس لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن ذلك في حديث ابن عمر. You're not allowed to put on your clothes زعفران and الورس. And زعفران الورس. زعفران is translated as saffron and الورس. I don't know what the translation is, but it's two types of perfume. They use it for perfume and they also use it to dye your clothes red. And it's a leaf that comes out from the Arab lands. And the Prophet ﷺ prohibited that because it is perfume. And this is narrated by Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, the Prophet ﷺ prohibited that. وَيَجْبُ عَلَى الْمُحْرِمِ أَنْ يَتْرُكَ الرَّفَثَ وَالْفُزُوقَ وَالْجِدَالِ. And it is obligatory upon the person who is in the state of ihram to leave off al-rafath. And al-rafath is al-jima' wa dawa'ih. It is having intercourse and anything that leads to that. Al-rafath. Allah says in the Quran, الحج أشهر معلومات فمن فرض فيهن الحج فلا رفث ولا فسوق ولا جدال في الحج. And القراءة فلا رفث ولا فسوق ولا جدال في الحج. So it says that in Allah for a person to do al-rafath, which is al-jima' wa dawa'i, to have intercourse and anything that leads to it. Wal-fusuq, and fusuq is what? It is major sins. نعم. Major sins. And where's the evidence for that? وكره أي نعم. In Surah Al-Hujurat, Allah says, Allah tells us the levels of the sins, and He says, وكره إليكم الكفر والفسوق والعصيان. الكفر is the highest level of sin, the sins that may take a person out of Islam. والفسوق, the major sins which makes a person a فاسق. والعصيان, and other sins. And Allah made that hated to you. So these are the levels of the sins. So in this, the Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ لَمْ يَرْفُثْ وَلَمْ يَفْسُقْ. It says, مَنْ حَجَّ فَلَمْ يَرْفُثْ وَلَمْ يَفْسُقْ رَجَعَ كَيَوْمِ وَلَدَتْ أُمُّهُ. The person who does not commit, he does not have intercourse, and he does not commit major sins, he comes back from his Hajj as if he has just, as if the day he was born, just like the day he was born. So al-fisq is major sins. And لذلك in مصطلح الحديث, we learn that the adala, the person who is thiqah or is adil, is a person who is من استقام مروءته و الثقه من استقام عدولته ومروءته ودينه. يعني his religion and his مروءة are firm. And how is the person's deen firm? By staying away from major sins. And they call this person a فاسق. Therefore, that's what's major sin. والجدال, and also arguing. And this قراءة, in the قراءة that we read is الجدالة. And this shows that this they say that the جدال here is جدال مخصوص, is a certain type of argument. جدال here means argument in Hajj. So it's not allowed for a person to argue. And they say that arguing here is in a certain type, and that is الجدال في المناسك, to argue about the different the ways of doing Hajj. And the reason of this is because that people at the time of Jahiliyyah, they'll do different things in Hajj. For example, the Quraysh, they wouldn't go to Arafah because they would say Arafah is not part of the Haram, and therefore we stay in Muzdalifah because we want to stay in the Haram. We're Quraysh. And the Prophet ﷺ came and told us how to do Hajj clearly. So in this ayah, the Prophet ﷺ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, prohibits us from arguing in terms of what the Prophet ﷺ has already taught us. Meaning, some people they'll come and they'll start arguing about how to do Hajj. But Hajj has been made clear. Hajj has been made clear. For a person to ask you, ask your sheikh, ask a teacher, and he'll clear it for you. So for a person to start arguing in the way that they used to do in Jahiliyyah, this was what prohibited. And the sheikh says, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says here, فَأَمَّا الْجِدَالَ بِالَّتِي بِهِيَ الْأَهِيَ أَحْسَنَ لِإِظْهَارِ الْحَقِّ وَرَدِّ الْبَاطِلِ فَلَا بَأْسَ بِهِ بَلْ هُوَ مَأْمُورٌ بِهِ. As for arguing, when it comes to refuting the falsehood and commanding the good, فَلَا بَأْسَ بِهِ, there's no problem with it. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, أُدْعُوا إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ جادلهم بالتي هي أحسن. Argue, call to the way of your Lord, and then at the end of that it says, argue them which is some, with what is good. So it is, this is the, so the argument that was mentioned in the ayah is a specific type of argument, which is بالباطل, for no reason. And also, and you find that subhanAllah, when you go to Hajj, you're going to be tested with your patience. And you find that you're going to argue with certain people. And to the point you'll see people fighting in Hajj. Na'am, because it's like, it's really, it tests your patience. So you find that this amr, this command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is really, yani, you see it, you see the reason why it's commanded when you go see in Hajj. Because you see the people fighting, and you see the people angry. You're waiting for 7 hours, 8 hours, maybe at the airport. Then after that you're waiting for Muzdalifah to Arafah. I think it's really bad, it's really hard. And just be prepared, sabr, 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 in Hajj. Na'am. So he says, وَيَحْرُمُ عَلَى الْمُحْرِمِ ذَكَرَ تَغْطِيَةُ الرَّأْسِ بِمُلَاقَةِ. And he says, they're not to cover your hair. And we mentioned that, the details of that. And the evidence for that is that when the person, when the, one of the companions, he was at Hajj in the, on Arafah, and he fell from his camel and he died, the Prophet ﷺ said, اِغْسِلُوهُ فِي ثَوْبَيْنِ اِغْسِلُوهُ بِمَاءٍ وَسِدْنٍ وَكَفِنُوهُ فِي ثَوْبَيْهِ وَلَا تُخَمِّرُوا رَأْسَهُ وَوَجْهَهُ. He said, put him in his burial shroud, but do not cover his head or his face. And this shows that it's not allowed for a person who's in the state of Ihram to cover their head or their face. And we say that the head, I mean, the face is not allowed to be covered unless there is a haja, there is a need. Because narrated from Uthman ibn Affan and Abdul Rahman ibn Auf that when a bad wind, a bad smell came to them, they covered their face with their hands and they turned away. And it shows that if there's a need for you to cover your face like that, then there's no problem. But if there's no need, then they say that a person should not cover their face. But the head, the hair is even worse, meaning it's not like the face. If a person covers their face, it's less than covering the head. If a person covers their head on purpose and they know that it's not allowed without a darura, without a necessity, then in this case the person has to pay fidya. Then he mentions more detail in that which we already mentioned. ويحرم على المحرم من الرجال والنساء قتل الصيد. To kill, to hunt, يعني it's not allowed to go hunting. We mentioned that. ويحرم على المسلم محرما كان أو غير محرم ذكرا كان أو أنثى قتل الصيد الحرام والمعاونة في قتله. So it's not allowed to kill, to go hunting in the haram, whether the person is in the state of ihram or not in the state of ihram, as we mentioned before. And also then he mentions a few rulings that are pertaining to the haram and not necessarily pertaining to Hajj specifically. And he says, وَيَحْرُمُ قَطْعُ الشَّجْرِ الْحَرَمُ وَنَبَاتِهِ الْأَخْضَرِ. It's not allowed for a person to cut the trees that are in the haram sanctuary, in the boundaries of the haram. You're not allowed to cut the natural trees from them. And the green leaves, meaning the leaves that are healthy. As for the leaves that are withering away and they're about to die, then you're allowed to take that off. And also they mentioned that you're allowed to cut off things that are harmful, such as thorns and things like that. And also in the hadith of when the Prophet ﷺ took over Mecca, and Al-Abbas, his uncle, he said, the Prophet ﷺ said that Mecca is haram. I didn't mention it here, but he says Mecca is haram. إن مكة حرام كيوم خلق كيوم خلق السماوات والأرض. So he says the haram, the Mecca is not Allah, is haram like the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created it on the day He created the heavens and the earth. Meaning Mecca was haram from that time, since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth. And He mentioned certain things that are not allowed to be done in Mecca. And from amongst those things is cutting trees. Al-Abbas radiallahu anhu, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, stood up and he says, إِلَّا الْإِذْخِرْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. He says, what about al-idhkhir? Al-idhkhir is a certain type of tree, a plant which they used for their houses. So the Prophet ﷺ said, إِلَّا الْإِذْخِرْ, except for إِذْخِرْ, meaning إِذْخِرْ, this type of tree, you're allowed to cut it and you're allowed to use it. But other than that, it's not allowed to take from the trees of the haram. وَلُقَطَتُهُ إِلَّا لِمَنْ يَعْرِفُهَا. And the things that are lost in the haram, for example, someone lost their wallet, the lost things, these things are not allowed to be taken except for a person who's going to take it and he's going to announce it forever, forever. You know, in outside of Mecca, if you find something, you announce it for 1 year, and after that you get to keep it. And if the person comes anytime, you give it back to him, or you give back whatever you spent from it. As for Mecca, it has a specific ruling, which is that it is not allowed to be taken. So if you find some money in Mecca, then you're not allowed to take it and keep it. Rather, you have to take it. If you're going to take it, then you have to announce it forever. Meaning put it in a place where it's going to be announced forever. Why? What's the hikmah behind that? Why Mecca? Because people come back now. He said, because people come back to Mecca every time. You know, Sheikh, one of our Sheikhs, Rasulullah Abbas, he said that a brother he knew 30 years ago, he lost his sunglasses in Mecca. And so he kept it for him. And he said after 30 years he came back and he gave him sunglasses back. 30 years he came back to Halal, to Mecca. Because people keep coming back to Mecca. And I lost 500 riyal in Mecca, but I haven't gone back to find it. I still don't know where it is. So he says, وَيَحْرُمُ عَلَى الْمُسْلِمُ مُحْرَمُ نعم, those are the things that are not allowed in haram. Then he mentioned one last point, which is, وَمِنَا وَمُزْدَلِفَ مِنَ الْحَرَمُ وَأَمَّا عَرَفَهْ فَمِنَ الْحِلِّ. And this point is that Mina, the place of Mina, which where the people stay in the tents, this is part of the haram sanctity. And also Muzdalifa, which is right next to Mina. And today you find that the tents of Mina are extended all the way to Muzdalifa till now. So you find that the sign, it says Muzdalifa starts here, but you still find tents in Muzdalifa. So all of that Mina all the way to Muzdalifa are all part of the haram. Meaning they are sanctity, they are part of the sanctity. And we have to realize that this place that is haram, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made haram for the people, made haram, made sacred. There are certain, these are the rulings that are pertaining to it. You're not allowed to cut off the trees, you're not allowed to hunt in that place, you're not allowed to even scare the birds that are there. You find a lot of pigeons in Mecca right now. If you go to Mecca, you find a lot of pigeons. You're not allowed to scare those pigeons. It's not allowed. You're not allowed to pick up things that you find in haram, in the haram area. And you find the boundaries are marked by signs today. So these things are not allowed. So he says, إِنَّ هَذَا الْبَلَدْ يَعْنِي مَكَّةِ حَرَامٌ بِحُرْمَةِ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ خَلَقَ السَّمَاءِ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ لَا يُعَضَّدُ شَجَرُهَا وَلَا يُنَفَّرُ سَيْدُهَا وَلَا يُخْتَلَى خَلَاهَا وَلَا يَحِلُّ سَاقِطُهَا إِلَّا الْمُشْرِكِ. Which we all mentioned. These are the things that are not allowed in Mecca. And he says, Mina and Muzdalifa are apart from Haram, are part of the Haram. So these rules apply to Mina and Muzdalifa. وَأَمَّا عَرَفَهْ فَمِنَ الْحِلِّ. As for Arafah, then it is part of the Hill, meaning it is not part of the sacred sanctity. So if a person now from Mecca, he lives in Mecca, and he wants to go to do Umrah, he has to leave the Haram sanctity, right? He has to leave the boundaries of the Haram. So for this person, he's allowed to go to Arafah and make his intention for Umrah, and then come back into Mecca, because Arafah is part of the Hill. And we have another chapter, like inshallah ta'ala, maybe we'll finish it tomorrow. We're not going to finish the book definitely. Like in the later chapters, only 2-3 more important, most important chapters. The later chapters, it talks about Al-Amr bil-Ma'roof, commanding the good and forbidding the evil. And it talks about Ziyara, how to visit the grave, the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and these kind of things. But tomorrow, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to finish the next few most important chapters in which he talks about the actual acts of Hajj. And I remind you guys that it's going to go over your head a lot of times if you haven't been to Hajj. It's going to go over your head. But just remember these rulings. But when you go to do Hajj, you will remember these rulings and they'll come to you inshallah ta'ala. So just have sabr, sabr, sabr. وَمَا صَبْرُكَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. Your sabr is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if there's any questions related to the topic and written down questions, we'll be given priority.